Today, we're getting our hands dirty with the math that really underpins all of modern finance. We're talking about Harry Markowitz's work on portfolio selection.
We are. This is really the foundation. If you want to go beyond just picking stocks and start thinking strategically about risk, this is where it all begins. Mm. And our sources today give us a very focused lesson on that fundamental building block, the simple two-asset portfolio.
And that's our mission for this deep dive. We're taking what is, I mean, a pretty dense academic lesson, and we're going to walk through it step by step.
That's right.
We want to figure out two core things for a hypothetical portfolio. First, what we expect to earn, the expected return.
And second, the standard deviation, which is just the technical term for how we measure the portfolio's risk.
Exactly. So we have this structured in three main parts for you. First, we'll lay out all the inputs. You know, what are our assets? How are we invested?
Then second, we'll calculate that expected return, which is written as E of RAP. And third, we'll get into the really interesting part, setting up the formula for portfolio variance and standard deviation. That's sigma P squared and sigma P.
Okay, let's start with those building blocks. We have to define our portfolio. The sources give us two make-believe investments, just called asset A and asset B.
And for any asset, you need two key numbers. The first is expected return. Think of it as the anticipated average return you'd get over time.
And a second.
The second is standard deviation. It's often shown with the Greek letter sigma. Yeah. And it's basically the universal way to quantify risk. It tells you how much the actual return tends to bounce around that expected average.
So it's a measure of volatility.
Precisely.
Okay, so our sources give us the numbers. Asset A, this one is our, let's say, safer bet. It has an expected return, an E of RA of 12%.
And its risk, its sigma A, is 40%.
Then we have asset B. This is the more aggressive choice.
Definitely the high octane option. The expected return, E of RB, is way up at 20%.
But that comes with a catch, right?
A very big catch. That potential reward is paired with a huge amount of risk. Its standard deviation, sigma B, is 90%.
Wow, 90. Okay, so now let's talk about how we actually invest. The example uses a total investment pool of 100,000 shekels.
Right, and the allocation is very specific. 70,000 of that goes into the safer one, asset A.
And the remaining 30,000 is put into the riskier asset B.
And these specific amounts are so important because they're how we figure out our portfolio weights. I mean, the proportion of our money that's in each asset.
And this is where it gets really interesting, where the Markowitz model, you know, changed everything. We need one more piece of data.
The connection between the two.
The correlation coefficient. This number tells us how the returns of asset A and asset B tend to move together.
And in our example, that correlation coefficient, which is written as rho AB, is 0.4.
Okay, 0.4. What does that actually mean in plain English?
It means they have a positive correlation. So when asset A has a good month, asset B, you know, probably had a good month too, they tend to move in the same direction.
But wait a minute. If they both go up and down together, how does that help with diversification? Isn't the whole point to find things that move in opposite directions?
That is the beautiful, subtle insight here. Because the correlation is imperfect. It's 0.4, not a perfect 1.0. We still get a diversification benefit.
Ah, okay.
If it were 1, there'd be no benefit at all. The portfolio's risk would just be a simple weighted average, but because they don't move in perfect lockstep, combining them actually reduces some of the overall risk. It's like a statistical free lunch.
That imperfection is everything. So we've got all our pieces on the board now. The big question is, for this specific 100,000 portfolio, what's the expected return and what's the standard deviation?
Let's start with the easier one. Step one, the expected return.
Why is this one easier?
Because return is a linear property. It's just a straightforward weighted average of the returns of the things inside the portfolio. So first, we just need to nail down those portfolio weights.
Right. We had 70,000 in asset A out of 100,000 total. So the weight for asset A, that's XA, is just 70,000 divided by 100,000.
Which is 0.7 or 70%.
And for asset B, XB, that's 30,000 out of 100,000, so 0.3.
And here's the quick sanity check you should always do. The weights, XA plus XB, have to add up to 1. 0.7 plus 0.3 equals 1. We're fully invested.
Perfect. So we have our weights. We know the returns for A and B. We can build the formula. The portfolio's expected return, E of RP, is just the weight of each asset multiplied by its own expected return, and then you add them all up.
And if we write that out in the formal academic way, the formula is E of RP equals XA times E of RA plus XB times E of RB.
Okay, let's plug the numbers in. And remember, when we do the math, we have to use the decimal versions of the percentages. So 12% is 0.12 and 20% is 0.20.
Right. So substituting those values in, we get E of RP equals, in parentheses, 0.7 times 0.12, plus in another set of parentheses, 0.3 times 0.20.
Let's do that first bit of multiplication. 0.7 times 0.12. That gives us 0.084.
And the second part, 0.3 times 0.20, that's 0.06.
So now we just add those two together, 0.084 plus 0.06.
And we land on our final answer of 0.144.
Which, if we turn that back into a percentage, means the expected return of our portfolio is 14.4%.
And let's just pause there. Does that number make sense? Asset A was 12%. Asset B was 20%. Our portfolio is 70% weighted towards A.
So yeah, our final number, 14.4, should be closer to 12 than to 20. And it is. So that logic checks out.
Exactly.
Okay. So we know what we can expect to make. Now for the hard part, the part that's really the genius of Markowitz. How do we calculate the risk that comes with that return?
Right. We're moving to step two. Portfolio variance, sigma p squared, and its square root, the standard deviation, sigma p. And you're right, this is where it gets tricky. We established return is a simple weighted average. Risk is absolutely not.
And remind us why. Why can't I just take 70% of asset A's risk and 30% of asset B's risk and add them up?
Because if you did that, you would be completely ignoring the relationship between the assets. You'd be throwing away that correlation coefficient, that 0.4, which means you would completely miss the whole benefit of diversification.
You have to account for how they move together, their covariance.
You must. To get the true risk, you need the full variance formula. And I'll warn you, the notation looks a bit scary at first.
Okay, let's see it. The formal equation for the portfolio's variance, sigma p squared.
Okay, it is xa squared times sigma a squared plus xb squared times sigma b squared plus 2 times xa times xb times sigma a times sigma b times rho ab.
Whoa. Okay. That's a mouthful. Let's break that monster down.
We can. The first two terms are actually pretty intuitive. The weight of a squared times the variance of a plus the weight of b squared times the variance of b. That's just the contribution of each asset's own individual risk to the portfolio.
Okay, so that's their standalone risk, properly weighted. But then there's that whole last chunk.
That last chunk is the covariance term. That is the engine of diversification. It's 2 times the weight of A times the weight of B times the standard deviation of A times the standard deviation of B, all multiplied by that correlation coefficient.
So it's that final number, the rho, the 0.4, that really controls how big or small that last term is.
Exactly. If the correlation was 1, that term would be at its maximum, and we'd get no risk reduction. Because ours is only 0.4, that term is smaller, which helps pull the total portfolio risk down.
The source material actually shows another way to write this, which I think makes it conceptually a bit clearer.
Yes, the alternative notation. It uses the terms variance and covariance directly. It goes sigma p squared equals xa squared times var of a plus xb squared times var of b plus 2 times xa times xb times cov of a.
That does make the different parts stand out. The first two terms are the individual variances, and that last part is the shared variance, the covariance.
Exactly. And just to be crystal clear on the terms, variance, or var, is just the standard deviation squared. So yeah. Var of A is the same thing as sigma A squared. We use the squared numbers in the middle of the calculation because the math is cleaner.
Right. And then at the very end, we just take the square root of the whole thing to get back to the standard deviation, which is the number we can actually interpret as risk.
That's the final step.
And that third term, cov of A, B, that's the shared risk component.
That's it. The covariance is just a single number that bundles the correlation and the individual standard deviations together. As we saw in that first big formula, the covariance of A and B is just rho AB times sigma A times sigma B. It's how much their volatilities move together.
Okay. So to recap where we are, we have our expected return, 14.4%. We have all the data we need, our weights of 0.7 and 0.3, our standard deviations of 40 and 90%, and our correlation of 0.4.
And we have the formula, two different ways of looking at it. But they're the same formula for calculating the portfolio's variance, sigma p squared.
We're basically set up now. We have everything we need to plug all those numbers into that big variance formula to get the final risk number for the portfolio.
We are. And the calculation itself is just arithmetic from here. But understanding this structure is the whole lesson.
It really is. The total risk isn't just the sum of the parts. It's the sum of the individual risks plus that interactive shared risk component.
And if you're wondering why this matters, why we're going through this with just two assets, it's because this logic is how everything in portfolio management is built. Whether you have five assets or 5,000, the math just scales up. It's all about weights, individual risks, and the correlations between every single pair of assets.
We've seen how a positive correlation of 0.4 still gives us a bit of a risk reduction benefit. But here's a final thought for you to take away. Markowitz showed that the real holy grail, the ultimate free lunch, is negative correlation.
Right.
So if you could find two assets that were perfectly negatively correlated, meaning a rock of negative one, think about what that would do. Look back at that big covariance term in the formula. What happens when you plug in a negative one? What could the impact on the portfolio's total risk be? That question, that's the whole point of diversification.